we're in a really different world than we're in when I first started reporting on this. In a minute, I'm going to show you a clip from this movie we made, Water Life. And the movie looks at the Great Lakes. It starts up in Lake Superior and follows the water down to the ocean. And in fact, Josephine Mandelman is one of the people who was all through the film. So since we made the movie, about almost 2 years now, it's been shown hundreds of screenings all around the lakes. And whenever I've been at a screening, I've always been shocked at the reaction for two reasons. One is that people invariably are amazed. The film talks about invasives, it talks about sewage overflows and toxic dumps and problems that for people in the Great Lakes community, for people who've worked on the environmental issues in the Great Lakes, are really old hat. These are problems that have been around for a long time. But the audiences that we show the film to are just amazed because they have no idea. You know, there's, I think we say in the film 35, I think Council of Canadians says 40 million people living around the lakes, but most of us live in cities, so we have very little interaction with the lakes and very little sense of what's going on them. And the other thing that surprises me is that the film invariably leaves people kind of despairing. They say, oh man, you know, what can we do? Is there any hope at all? And I always say to them, these are matters of infrastructure. I mean, some of the problems that Mark talked about are very complex, but a lot of the problems on the lakes are simple. The sewer pipes dump sewage in, the old toxic, I come from Niagara, the Niagara River is lined with old toxic waste dumps, and they're leaking into the river because they're just dug in shale. So the problems, a lot of the problems on the Great Lakes are matters that could easily be solved with legislation, regulation, and plumbing. But people don't realize that, and they have what I think of as a kind of a cultivated ignorance. And by that I mean it's not inherent ignorance, it's been cultivated. The companies and the governments that want to have their surly way with the environment prefer us all to be in the dark and prefer that information about what's going on in the lakes and in fact what can be done to improve them doesn't get out. And over my career, 3 decades of being a reporter, I've seen them. Things have gotten darker in that sense. In 1990, half the newspapers in North America had an environmental reporter. Today, it's less than a quarter have environmental reporters. So the story doesn't get out. People don't perceive it. And I can tell you, as somebody who spends their days going around knocking on the doors of television companies trying to get money to make movies about the environment, it's a pretty hopeless task. So it means that we're left to our own devices, to our, in my case, my films, our speeches, our social media, and really importantly, our conversations with our neighbors. So I want to say that I'm really grateful to Maud and the Council of Canadians for framing that conversation in a way for us, giving us, you know, what's really quite a simple message. It's common water, it should be a commons. We're 75% water. Whatever happens out in those lakes, if you live on the Great Lakes, it's you. It literally is you. So I thank you for framing that for us, and I urge you all to go and have the conversation with your neighbors because it's the only way that the message can spread. Thank you very much, and I'll show you a little clip from the film. So this is the trailer from the film.
People do have a right to a clean environment. But somebody's deciding risk factors for you. We give up on the Great Lakes. We wonder if there's such a thing as human wisdom.
We are completely surrounded by the petrochemical industry.
Most of the chemicals that come out of industrial facilities, petrochemicals, pesticides, heavy metals, don't dissolve in water.
Every chemical that we've looked for, we have found.
We're living in a soup of chemicals.
The J generation of my daughters have grown to trust that the government is watching the environment, and sometimes it's not happening.
There are all sorts of modern substances that we are exposed to. We don't really understand and feel that we are being exposed.
Everything has its consequences, both good and bad.
You don't think everything through carefully, you don't know what kind of undesirable side effects you might wind up with.
I used to have ducks, I used to have geese, I used to have snapping turtles.
Well, a lot of good fish die out.
I believe the lake is turning into a bog.
Pour through the heart of North America and the lives of 35 million lucky people who have plenty to drink in a thirsty world. In that journey lies the story of the last great supply of fresh water on Earth.
I made a lot of mistakes. I made a lot of mistakes.
This evening, I'm going to invite Mark Mattson up. Mark is the Lake Ontario water keeper. Welcome, Mark.
Thank you. I'm going to try and keep the sound really smooth by standing back here and maybe letting my voice project. I hope everyone can hear me. First of all, I'd like to thank Council of Canadians, Mark, Maud, for bringing everyone here together and starting this really important push to have the Great Lakes declared a public trust. I can tell you that the Waterkeeper organization consists of over 200 groups from 17 different countries. And no matter where I go and what conference I go to, and I've been on the board for 10 years, every single waterkeeper, riverkeeper, baykeeper, soundkeeper knows of Maud Barlow and knows of her work. It amazes me how she's able to truly reach out and touch people and bring them to these causes. And I think it's because Maud always puts people over politics and policy. And so this is such an important time on the Great Lakes. I'm going to tell you a bit of a story that sort of brings that around, why I think this is such an important time for all of us tonight. But first, I also wanted to let the Council of Canadians and Maud know that I was in Portland last week and precipitated by their request to the IJC to have the Great Lakes declared a public trust. The Waterkeeper Alliance had a motion brought forward by our American waterkeeper organizations, brought forward to the board, and to declare that we support and advocate for a public trust on the Great Lakes as well. So, signed by Robert Kennedy Jr. And I just wanted Maud to know that she's starting a movement. And there's a lot of people who are paying attention. And I can say I've been on the Waterkeeper Alliance board for 10 years. And we've had motions brought from all over the world. And we didn't really want to set this precedent. But this is such an important concept that you own these lakes. Not the government, not the corporations. And you have to constantly remind yourself of that because you're obviously, and we're all obviously being told that others can deal with these lakes and these issues better than we can. And we're being told that we're red tape when we speak up about issues. The hearing processes are being removed. The science is being lost. The jurisdictions and the government issues are being fought behind closed doors with stakeholders. And no longer do people understand that these are our Great Lakes. So the very concept of the public trust goes to the very deepest and the roots of the environmental movement. And that's why it's such an important issue. And it was unanimous and it was quickly adopted by the Waterkeeper organization. I want to just tell you a bit of a story, and hopefully the story will help to underscore why this is such an important time and what the Council of Canadians is doing now. Kicking off this Great Lakes tour tonight is so important. I grew up on a little island called Wolf Island. It's at the end of Lake Ontario, where the St. Lawrence River begins to flow. And if you pushed Wolf Island in, you know, it would sort of block all the Great Lakes. It's sort of like a cork down there. And it's a small farming community with a little bit of fishing, and our family had had it as a place to go for years and years, long before I came along. And those were great times in the 1960s. And I remember in 1967, during Expo 67, we went to Montreal. And we always ate the fish. And that's where I learned to swim, of course. And we drank the water. And Expo 67 was such a great mythological time for us. And I was so young, and I was in Canada, and looking up at that pavilion and seeing Montreal in the world light on the St. Lawrence River brought a lot of pride to us. And I was also noticing, and people were talking at the kitchen table around our houses and the cottages and the little farming communities in Wolf Island about these changes taking place in the Great Lakes. As Maud alluded to tonight, it was only 58, 59 when the Great Lakes, or when the power dams were built and the St. Lawrence Seaway opened. Well, this was just, you know, 7, 8, 9 years later. So we were seeing a lot of changes. The waters didn't rise and set as, didn't rise and empty as much as they used to. The wetlands were changing. The fish, many of them were disappearing. Exotic species were beginning to really have a plight. Our bay was filling full of weeds from the sewage and the phosphorus from overcrowding in our communities. And then we heard about grassy narrows in the First Nations communities and the impact that mercury can have on children and families from eating fish that are contaminated with mercury. And then heard about the Cuyahoga starting on fire just down on the other end of the lake somewhere, on other end of Lake Erie. And I'm not sure if many of you recall, but in 1972, 40 years ago, about a month ago, was the biggest public demonstration in the United States of America, where people came out on Earth Day and demanded that their government begin to take action again on behalf of the people. And that's when the Clean Water Act, its 40th anniversary today, is this year, and the Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement were signed. And both of those pieces of legislation said that these waters, and Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement includes Canada, need to be swimmable, drinkable, fishable. That's where those terms came from. And certainly this precipitated a great deal of change on the Great Lakes. And again, growing up down on Wolf Island, I saw those changes. Not as great maybe as, with a bigger perspective that you could see generation to generation, but we did see changes. And some for the good, but some not for the so good. And after I went to university and ultimately went back to Queens, because when I got to go to university, I rushed back down to Kingston, a man who was a criminal lawyer who I knew in the 60s and was a friend of my father, had traveled and became a commercial fisherman in BC, and he came back to the Great Lakes and he said, "It's awful. Things are getting worse." And we were thinking things were getting better. And he said, "In fact, it's so bad I can no longer with a conscience continue my practice of criminal law." And in 1985, when Minister Jim Bradley here in Ontario created one of the greatest environmental enforcement teams, and a concept that to this day still stands out as one of the truly high watermarks in enforcing environmental law, the Investigative Enforcement Branch and Legal Services here in Ontario, he applied for the job and got it. And I went off to law school, and for the first time in my life, I knew what I wanted to do with a law degree, and that was to be an environmental lawyer. And so when I came out in 1988, and I practiced and was a, I actually worked downtown Toronto and articled, I immediately tried to get into environmental law because the first time ever there truly was an opportunity to give meaning and force to environmental laws like people give meaning and force to labor laws and to civil rights laws. And it wasn't that much longer until the government started realizing that there was a lot of pushback from enforcing these laws on the Great Lakes. And in 1990, they began to disband the Investigative Enforcement Branch and the IEB. And in 1995, when Harris government came in, one of the first things he did was to remove the regional directors. Lucky for me, I had been prosecuting with the Ministry of Environment on contract with Mr. Chapman after he left the Ministry of Environment, and I learned about environmental laws, and I learned how to use them. And I learned about the impacts they can make and the communities that benefited from these laws being enforced. And yes, like Kevin said, there were always solutions. It was plumbing, it was infrastructure, it was money that needed to be spent, siting, scale, terms and conditions, turning promises into actually legal enforcement or legally enforceable terms and conditions. And these were done through processes, and these were done through the important laws in Ontario. When Mike Harris came in, he really changed that. And very soon after that, by year 2000, I had been practicing investigating environmental crimes and prosecuting using the Fisheries Act to do private prosecutions because the government wasn't doing it. And the Fisheries Act in Canada says that in order to encourage the public to participate in community resources, they allow citizens to step in the place of government and enforce those laws. And so we were doing that for a number of years, and I did it in Moncton, Montreal, Toronto, Hamilton, Kingston, brought a case against the Ministry of Environment for a major landfill up on DeLaurel. But at the end, you know, it really became pretty clear to me that I was failing to really achieve the vision of a swimmable, drinkable lake. Enforcing the laws wasn't enough. Doing it as an independent organization without the resources of government or the commitment of government as a partner, certainly I wasn't going to make the changes that were necessary. And I realized then and there that we needed to rebuild our community, that we needed to build and educate people around the lakes again who cared about the Great Lakes, who knew what species of fish were in the lakes, who knew where their drinking water came from, who knew that if you lived in Toronto, what's your watershed? Is it the Dufferin's, the Credit, the Mimico, the Humber, the Rouge, the Highland, the Petticoat? Where do you live in Toronto in the nine watersheds? Or in Hamilton, or in Kingston? We needed to know where our beaches were. One of the first things when I started the Waterkeeper Organization to do this, to build a community, because I liked the idea that we would build a community of people around the lake who would stand up and be a voice for the lake. And we would have a lake that we could swim, drink, and fish in. And one of the first things in Toronto, they had 20 beaches. And I remember I didn't know any of their names at the time, and there wasn't much talk in Toronto about swimming in the beaches. And the city of Toronto shut down 9 of them. There wasn't a word about it. You would have had to have gone, and I think we had websites then by year 2000, or go to the library to find out they shut down 9. And I realized that we needed to start to talk about our beaches, our public spaces. Why are they open, or why are they closed? Where are they? How do they get there? Who's out there in our community understanding and knowing how special these places are? Because if you don't have contact to the Great Lakes, this is an amazing place right here that we are today, and these people rowing, and you know, when I bring people, guests to Toronto, I love to come to the Toronto Argonaut Club and say, can we go out there and row? Because what a great way to experience the lake. But how many places do we have left with public access? Safe places where you can bring your family. And so I realized we had to build a community. And over the course of the next 20 years, we started doing that. But as we were building this community, I can tell you one thing. Everything about the environmental laws that started in 72 started to unravel. We haven't had an environmental assessment hearing, a full hearing process in Ontario. And I used to do these in the early 90s, in decade. We just don't have them anymore. And even when they get ordered, we don't know if we get a hearing, get a process, bring forward the information, notice and comment, let the people know. I know the Melanchthon people are here. They have a...